the book, there's a clear distinction between history and then there's history. So history written with a hyphen between the high and the story. Is that different? What's the difference if there is any?
It would actually be interesting to know what the guys thought when they were reading it, what the difference is.
I think I had somebody in the book club who was asking, Ndu, did you manage to find the difference between history and history?
No, but I thought the H-I with a hyphen was more of a man, who's on who gets to say what history it is.
Because Zaman is the one telling the story. I mean, yeah, history is the fragmented stories that Zaman is trying to put together, right? It's not just his history. There's Farmer Quantum, who I don't know why liberals came to hate him, I wonder. So there's different, there's Mama Agnes, there's Tandy, there's Black Jesus. I got into trouble for naming him Black Jesus. People thought I was being anti-black. It's a real liberation war name. Like the person named themselves Black Jesus. It was initially a liberation war name, but then it became perverted post-liberation. So it's the difference for me is those histories that are being told versus history, the authoritative version. Like the one in the history books, the one on TV, the one the colonizers decided to tell us.
Now, if you get a bit into the writing, and into the book. Some aspects of the book, for example, Ukurahundi, it's a silent past. It's one of those things I'd call, you know, the stones that are better left than turned. And not only because the government has silenced this part of history, but because even the people themselves are not willing to confront it and talk about it. So for you, at what age did you learn about Bukurahundi and what was it that piqued your interest to want to address it in a book?
So we knew, everyone, I think in Zimbabwe knows about Bukurahundi, but to know it is a different thing. So growing up, we knew it was associated with trouble, so it's not something that you wanted to look at. So even in my family, you were discouraged from talking about it, but then you find resentment from and the village, both my family and my community, even for the front of them, right? So of course, growing up, you were singing Kumbaya, like, let's all love each other, why do we hate each other? You know, like, for someone who's in the village, the family married the front of them, that's a big thing, and the uncle won't attend the wedding, how dare you? Let's go away with tribalism. And then also, there was a review in Zimbabwe, and it said that genocide is not a fun topic. It's not something that's enjoyable to look at. It's very traumatic. It's very unpleasant. It's very difficult. So of course, looking at it was shocking. But again, for me, it was personal. When I asked my mother, I always say I was younger than her, but I was 25. So you know, she was cooking, and because I asked her successfully about the Liberation War, I'm like, oh, you know, hi mom, what's up? How was your day? Tell me about the girl. Almost going to stop. And then she got upset, so she froze, and I was interested in that. So I tried to kiss her, got really angry. And for me, that moved around from being just a general something personal. I was really interested now to sort of learn about my mother, a family, just makes you look at people differently. And this woman who, what you call normal, she's not sure what you call victim, lived through this period, and obviously I'm upset, so why? So that's when I went deep. And of course, reading about it was shocking. It's interesting now because I wrote the book and I spent a long time reading about it and then reimagining it. It seems almost normal to talk about it, to such an extent that sometimes I'm angry when Zimbabweans don't. And then I forget that there was a time when I couldn't talk about it, when I had to learn to try and look at it. But it became so important to me because it just felt like a wound that's festering. Considered Zimbabwe's first sin. Now, why it's hard to talk about is because it's associated with trouble. It's associated with trying to break the country apart. It's associated with trying to go down another pit. Then there's an even more complex history. The narrative that's been told, where it was state sanctioned, was that this was revenge against the Ndebele people for the violence they visited on the shoreline. They visited in the 19th century. go back to curriculum at times, it's really, but it's a very powerful statement in Zimbabwe. So you find people who argue around the issue. And it's also because people are not allowed to. No, we haven't really delved into the ground, and by that, like the whole of it, to see what was it like, to go beyond saying, this is the village, and fellow Zimbabweans. I don't know how Kenya deals with, like, say, Somali population. It would be like, fellow Kenyans, or you Somali, it's a very different thing, right? So that distinction between the village and Shona is a very powerful factor in not talking about it in Zimbabwe.
So in the book, you talk about fictionalized political figures, and you went all in, no tills. You named them, you shamed them. You know, there is crocodile, and the crocodile, and then you talk about Black Jesus. You even talk about Mugabe. Yes. Were you concerned, or were you scared at any one point that you would receive backlash in, you know, in exposing them in this book? And since the book was published in 2018, has there been any backlash or pushback from this political class?
Sorry, for those who love Mugabe, I know he's loved in Africa, and I apologize. He's never loved for Mugabe. He's loved everywhere, oh my God. I don't know if Kenya loves him. Mugabe is your Kenyatta, but maybe I shouldn't talk about Kenyatta. I'm gonna get stoned. It's not my country. Country saying things, but Mugabe and Kenyatta say my top food. you know, there's nothing, I think, to be honest, there's nothing in the book that's written that's not known, and that's the difference. And I think in what you call authoritative society, people know these things. I think what becomes a shock or what excites people, what people want, it's being able to say these things out loud, and then can you get away with it? Which is a sort of different thing. Which is why in the novel, for instance, I'm interested in Black Jesus as a fictionalized figure and not just as a person. So there's this, you know, there was this review that said, oh, there's Black Jesus, then it starts giving you a Wikipedia breakdown. That's boring, right? Like, there's no need for me to write a Wikipedia. You can find that on Wikipedia. So what fascinated me about Black Jesus was that he was the one who was the leader of the Fifth Brigade. And then in the testimonies from the victims, he came up several times, being depicted as this really evil character. So that was fascinating. And then he was our Air Force commander in Zimbabwe. He's part of this group called the Junta. The Junta are secret men behind the men, like the men, the government behind the government, sort of scandals. And then he was recently became a minister of agricultural land in the government. And our generals are now in government, which is interesting. They've got degrees though, they've got PhDs. Whether they're real or not, we have PhD generals. Rumor is some of them have them and people write them for them. But anyway. So then I was reading up about Black Jesus, then I discovered that he has children. He has sons. And then it struck me that, oh, this man probably is a loving person to his family. And so that was an interesting fictionalization for me, was trying to, you know, how do you try and get close to Tara, which is for me what Black Jesus is, but in a very intimate way. And I think Zamari tries to do that, and he tries to claim that Tara. But more interesting for me was also Black Jesus as a person, beyond being the monster. That contradiction and how to reconcile the two. The crocodile, that one, can't even do speeches properly. He gave his eulogy at his funeral, that had people who wrote him. But then there's General Bay. You guys don't know our General Bay?
Do you know the crocodile?
Yeah. Okay. And General Bay? Yeah, he's called General Bay, during the coup they had banners of him. My general is Bay, so that's his nickname. And he is our vice president, Chiwenga. Also a notorious villainous figure. So me, it was just, I think, was important to name, because this is not the first book to talk about people of Rohingya amongst other things, there's the stone, what? The stone virgins. The stone, no, no, is it the stone or butterfly virgin? Oh my god, one of the two. I read it. The stone virgins, and then there is Running with Magda. But I'm told this is the first book that names the girl with my name. So I think it was important for me just to read names, but also just to show that it was possible to name. As for trouble, not really, except they refused to publish the book in Zimbabwe because of the Black Jesus thing. But nothing other than that has happened. There was just an exciting time where Jonathan Moyo, who's in exile in Nairobi, Kenya. You guys know Jonathan? Former Minister of Information and Education. You guys, he was the mastermind behind our year 2000 fiasco.
He's not here officially.
Again?
He's not here officially.
Oh, he tells us that he's in exile. I was hoping. So yeah, it was just nice when he shot out the book and then turned out to see MTC, Secretary, former Minister, and Zimbabwe also made a shout out. So it was just nice to have the book read seriously, what I'm saying, by big men, political figures. Something we really do.